I chose that video this morning because the message I've been working on for a couple of weeks was very, very, very similar. And I want you to see that because we are the church. And there's the call out there to be the church. If you have a Bible with you this morning, I'd like to open to the book of Jude. And if you don't know where Jude is, it's the last book right before the book of Revelation. Everybody knows the book of Revelation, that's because it's the very last book, right? It's a little bit short, one chapter book. I'm just going to put one verse out of here this morning, maybe two at the most. But I want you to read this for me. I know they'll have it up on the screen. In verse 3 of this, he says, listen, it says, dear friends, I have been eagerly planning to write to you about the salvation that we share. But now I find that I must write to you about something else, urging you to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time unto his holy people, entrusting you with the faith. And he's asking us to defend that same faith that we have in God. So as I was looking at this verse and I watched this video, I was sort of thinking this whole time, this world is so full of discouragement. And everywhere we look in the seven air in the world, there's so many, even in Adam and Eve, we see fear and things that we're afraid of. And one of those things that there is, you can't. It says, you can't. In other words, it's too much to overcome. You need to quit or you need to give up. You can't change. You have to tolerate everything that's there. It's too messy. Don't get involved in it. This world has just gone too far. This situation is just too far gone to make a difference in it. And this is the lie that has come from the beginning of sin. It's a fear that we have inside, and we get afraid of what we're going to do or what we can or cannot do, and then we lose sight of who we really are in God's eyes. So I'm afraid that the church is laid down a little bit. I'm afraid the church is not doing what they're supposed to be doing because it's afraid. It's afraid of who might come through the door and say, we're going to sue you. And here's what we might say something bad about the church or about the way that something's going on. Well, we've become afraid of the world and what's going on in the world. The church has gone dormant. It's not speaking up. It's not saying anything. And why is that? Why are we so afraid when the world says, look, you can't do this. You yourself, you cannot do it. And you say, well, it's a huge mess and I don't want to get involved. What's happened? Well, what's become of the church that God has set apart? So as I was watching these videos, I've watched these things unfold. And it simply asks, do you think you can make a difference? And I guarantee if I polled you in this room this morning, there'd be a vague amount of answers. And we ask, do you have the solutions? Is the cause worth fighting for? Is the story worth telling? Do you believe that these people, the people sitting around this room, can really make a difference? Do you believe that one church can make a difference? When Adam and Eve were in the garden, and God had set aside the one tree not to eat off of, and Satan shows up as a serpent, and he beguiles Eve, he tricks Eve, he lies to Eve, and says, oh, well, you'll be just like God. If you just eat this fruit, and she did, and sin entered into the world. But from that moment, Satan told a lie to make Eve believe something she knew that wasn't true. At that point, Satan convinced Eve of something. And I'm going to tell you, Satan is still lying to us today. He's still saying to your church that you can't make a difference. Baloney. He's still lying. He's still trying to cause fear and disruption. When God says, look, you are my church. Okay? He says, you are mine. I am yours and you are mine. There's nothing that you cannot do as an individual. There's nothing we cannot do as a church together. Nothing. Because, see, God has put all this stuff together. Do you agree with that said? It said, don't you remember these things, okay? It says, you are the light of what? The world. You are the light of the world. Why? Because you have Christ in you. He illuminates and he puts light up. We are in the world, so we are the light of Christ in this world. Am I not right on that? Am I wrong? Come on, yes and no. Y'all know this. I've trained y'all. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, this is John 8:12, I am the light of the world. walk in darkness because you have what? The light that leads to life. That you have it. That God has given it to you. And that makes you a light in this dark and dying world. So we have a promise right there of something that's amazing within itself. That you are carrying the light of Christ from within you. And you may be the only light that walks out of the darkness in this world. He says you're a city on a hill. And you may have been driving and you've been on a dark stretch of road, but you see the lights kind of reflecting off the sky. And it's just like a low murmur of lights that glow. And you knew what? You knew there was something that were putting off a lot of light. You knew it was a city or a town, right? I remember one time I flew to Dallas, and as I was flying, you could look down over so high, and you could see these little splotches of lights. And they looked like they were this close together, but actually they were towns that were spread out all the way between here and Dallas. You knew it was a light. But imagine a city on a hill. No matter where you went around, if it was dark, you would see the lights of that city. And this is what God says. You are my city on a hill. You are the light of a place in the world to shine through the darkness so people would have a place of refuge, so they would have a place of salvation, so they can come to the light. That's you. He has put you in this world to be a light in darkness because he is in you. That's you. He says, be the church. Be the church. Don't be afraid. Don't run and cower down. Be the church. This thing went around a while back about preaching about homosexuality in the pulpit. Well, if you preach about in the pulpit, we'll come and arrest you. Hey, I'm on live internet right now. Here I am. Homosexuality is wrong. Period. No ifs, ands, questions. I mean, I hate homosexuals? Absolutely not. I pray for them all the time. I've got people I went to school with that are homosexuals. I pray for them. I hate the sin. But just like Jesus did, I love the sin. You see, Jesus, remember what the Pharisees said? And this kills me because I'm looking at churches. They knew what the Pharisees did? Oh my goodness, Jesus is going into sinners' houses and eating. He's associating with sinners. Yeah, thank you, Lord, that he did because I'm a sinner. See, we all have our problems. We all have our sin. But God loves you and can forgive you. Isn't that amazing? He cares enough about you to say, I know what you did was wrong, but I love you and I forgive you. If you're simply honest. Then he puts us in this world, and this world is pounds and pounds and pounds and pounds on us with all this you can't do it, don't get involved, stay away from it. And this is the biggest lie, because what God says, look, I put you in this position, I came to you, I saved you, I put you in a group of believers, and I made a church out of you, and I want you to go out into this world, and I want you to tell other people about me, and I want you to love other people, and I want people to see me in you, because you're hear from me. You're my ambassador. You're my representative. I want you to go and do. Period. And let this world beat us up and talk us out of it. It's exactly what Satan wants. You don't want to do that. Oh, it's a mess. You don't want to get in there. Oh, you might get hurt. You know what? I've been hurt before. I got over it. I've been through it. I've done it. Got the t-shirt. What God wants from us is us to be his. He wants us to be his person. He wants us to be his church. And he wants us to march out in the darkness and shine his light everywhere we go. And they think, well, you know what? I don't know that I can do that. Well, Satan's already, you've already bound him in the life, Satan, because you can. He's given you the ability. He's given you the power to do just that. He said, look, in Matthew 5:13, you are what? The salt of the earth. He says, but what good is salt if it's lost its flavor? He says, can you make it salty again? No. It'll be thrown out and trampled under the foot as worthless. And he says, you are the salt of the earth. You are what makes the earth different. Those of us who have accepted Christ and become a born-again believer, you are what makes this earth meaningful. Because you have the ability within you to go and tell and do for God. You are the salt of the earth. I mean, I like salt. I don't know. Watermelon? No, that's good. I love it. Cantaloupe? Makes it taste good, doesn't it? This salt. Somebody say, no, I've got high blood pressure. I can't do that. Well, I still can. I will. I like it. It makes it good. God has said, look, that's what makes this world good is that I am in you and you are in the world. Are we part of this world? Absolutely not. We're just a passing through, as the psalm says. But I and you is what makes this world worth something. And God still cares about this world. He has not wrote it off just yet. But what he is asking is for the church to arise out of the ashes, to stand up and be the church that he's called it to be. And that death is to be the church. Be Christ's church. Be God's church. Be the refuge that I've called you to be. Be the witness that I've called you to be. Be the light in the darkness. Be the church. He also says, you are more than conquerors. Romans 8:37, I love the New Living Translation, says, no, despite all these things, listen, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. If you read that in the King James, he'll say, you are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us first. You are more than what this world says you are, whether you know it or not. You are more than what you think you are. Because if you have Christ in your heart this morning, you are more than a conqueror in this world. You are able to do things that you don't even think you can do. If you come to me when I was 16 and said, you're going to be a preacher, I'd have laughed you out of the ballpark. Okay? I had no idea. The first time I preached, I was so nervous I couldn't even speak. My knees not so hard, they were even forward. What is that tapping sound? But God showed me something. He let me see with his eyes for just a little bit, and I saw the hurt and the disgust that's in this world, and what a foothold Satan already has in it, and how he can mess your life up like that before you even realize it. If you bind into the lie that you can't, because you can. God says you are more than a conqueror. That's more than enough for me. We can go out into this world and we can do what we're supposed to do as individuals and as a church. And what he's asking us to do is not beyond what we can do. He's already provided. He's already given us the ability. He's already doing it. What he asks us to do is to get off the padded chairs where they're comfortable, aren't they? To get off the chairs and get out from these walls and be in the fields where the work is. If a farmer sits in his farmhouse all the time, he's not a farmer. He may own a farm, but he's not a farmer. It's not doing the work. And if a church sits in its walls all the time, it's not a church. It's something entirely different. You see, God has pulled us together, and it's like tools in a toolbox. Every tool, and guys, you bear with me, listen, you know it's true. Every tool has a purpose. Every tool, each wrench fits a certain size of bolt. Each pliers have a job. Wire cutters have a job. All those tools have a job. He has assembled us in God's toolbox. It says, look, go out there. You've got the tools to do the job. Do the job. You are a tool that God uses in this world. I don't know what your specific written size or whatever it is that you do, but God does, and I think you do. And if you'll sit and submit to him and do it, you'll watch the work get done. So how do we be the church that God wants us to be? He's called us to be this church, this toolbox full of tools. He's ready for us to do it. For there is a new day right now at Bridges of Hope, because when we walk out of this place, we all have specific jobs that we'll go to. And I'm not talking about your employment. I'm talking about what God has asked you to do for him. You may choose not to do it, and that's between you and him. We as a church have a community that needs Christ now more than ever. We live in a community that is corrupted, and so it's just like every other community. It may be, the difference is you live in it. It's your community. It's your place where you live, and where most of you grew up. And when we go out into this community, we take it back for God. And the only way that's going to happen is if we get off the padded chairs and decide, you know what, I need to work for the Lord. There's stuff I need to do. I need to serve. I need to find my place with him, and I need to do. You know why? Well, let me show you why. I want you to notice in that video, he said this, we have been called to be the mouth of God. We have been called to be the hands of God, and we've called to be the feet of God. And I want you to think about those three things right there for just a minute, because the first one, the mouth, hey, I know a lot of y'all gab real good. I've heard you. God has called us to go out in this world and show with our lips who he is. He's called us to go out in this world with our mouth and sing praises to him. He's called us to go and take our mouth and share with others. What about your hands? You don't realize that this, don't you look, I heard your hand up. Don't you look at it real good? yourself to one more, right? So that is the most perfect design of a working tool that's ever been made. Think about it. Look at all the hand can do. God had made that for that reason. It has the ability to work. It has the ability to grasp, to do things, right? God, give us hands to work with. And he says, let be my hands. Do my work. Use your mouth. Be my mouth. Speak for me. And all of that, he gives us the feet. He says, let be my feet. What we do with feet, we go. We'll get it going. We go, and we go, and we use our hands, and we use our mouth, and we be the parts of God that he needs us to be here. He has put this before you and said, look, I've given you the ability, I've given you the power, I've given you the strength. Go, work, and tell. Now, we're in dire times. What's the news? What do you say? Should I need to turn over the book of Revelation and explain to y'all how this is unfolding. Because if you need me to, I will, maybe after church, not right now. We'll get there this time. It's coming. And there's no time like today to get this right. But we have to ask ourselves, is that what I really want? We have to look down in our own hearts and say, is this what you really want from me? Is this what I want? What do I need to do? Let me read you another scripture. We've been called to be the bride of Christ, the church of Christ. Matthew 28, 19, 26. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Did you hear what was in this verse? Listen. Go, feet, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Go, your feet, make your hands, and then he says, look, teach these disciples your mouth. Well, you found in that little passage that we are the mouth, the hands, and the feet of God in this world, and that our responsibility is to carry the banner of Christ out in the darkness and be the light. That they need it, whether they know it or not, they need it. And what we have to make up and decide this morning in this very laws, in this very room, we have to decide this. Am I willing to do it for God? Did he pay enough for me to do this? He gave his life for you to have this ability. I think he paid enough. He was beaten, crucified, mocked. I think he paid enough. We have the ability and the tools and the power to do it if we so choose. We are the church. We are said, be the church. So I don't think that God called us to build huge buildings and set inside and glorify what we think we are. I can glorify Christ in the parking lot as well as I can in this pulpit. This is our sanctuary. This is really me. This is a meeting room to me. The work is in the fields. And God has called us to be in the field working. And we'll enjoy it. We'll smile while we do it because we have the joy of Christ in our heart. And we know we're doing it for the right reason. Not for my benefit, not for your benefit, not for your name, not for anything other than the glory of God. When someone gets saved, we give it to God because he's the one that chose and called him. He's putting people in your midst to go and do the work. I have another scripture for you this morning. This is Romans 12, verse 2. It says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Do not copy the behavior of this world. Do you understand what that means? We're not to be like everybody else in this world. What did he say to do? Did you hear that? That's what he meant. He said, let God transform you into a new person. That's scary, isn't it? I'm kind of like who I am. I wonder if they want God to transform me into a whole new person. Right? Let me tell you, if God's in it, it'll be perfect. Are you tired of who you are? Are you tired of the mistakes you're making or made? ask God to transform me. God, transform my mind and my heart, and let me see things the way you see them. Be the church, the bride of Christ, what God has called you and designed you to be. He's given you an opportunity to step out into this world and glow and be illuminated by Him. The hands, the feet, the mouth. He's given you a chance, an opportunity to say, I know I'm more, and I want to be more. And church, He's given us opportunity to be more than what we are. We'll be more than bridges of hope. We'll be a house of refuge. We'll be a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit. And I'm not talking about the building. We'll be salvation. We'll be something people go up down the highway. Hey, that's that place where God lives. Maybe they see us all come in and say, look, those godly people. Not for our benefit, for His. You see, when we choose to get things right, we choose to be the right way, we choose to be the church that God's called us to be, you're going to see something happen that you can explain. You're going to see us having knockout walls because we don't have enough room to get everybody in here. You're going to see us adding chairs in places you wouldn't think we'd have to add chairs. Not because we're going to be bigger, but because it's where God's people are. And people want to be where God is. They want to be where His Spirit resides. And you'll see people get released. You'll see missions starting. You'll see activities going on. You'll think, wow, how did this even happen? And you'll step back and say, thank you, Lord. And it may be just in your life this morning that there's so much turmoil and so much strife, and you have bought into the lie that you cannot. You've bought into the lie that says you can't do this or you don't want to do this. You have bought into the lie that He has thrown in front of you. And you knew better. But you did it. He can transform you. He can change that. I'm not going to lie and say there's not consequences to our actions, but there is this. When the love of God falls upon you and you stand and you praise Him, it's sweet. It's so much sweeter than living in the turmoil and living in the pit. My God is good. My God is all the time good. And church, He has called us to be the church. No more playing around. No more games. We're not waiting any longer. We've said dormant long enough. The work begins. If you can't handle the work, get out of the way because the train's coming through. Because there's those in here that will work. If you want to get plugged in, you want to get involved, you want to be on a team with God and just do what you can do, watch what happens. Watch. Just watch what God can do. You can just pray with me this morning. Father, I wish I had the ability of knowing everybody's heart condition here this morning, but I don't.